we'll be discussing the issues in life sciences. We have thousands of underdrugged and undrugged diseases, millions of patients in search of new medicines and pharmaceuticals, and we'll be addressing that topic. But there's many other topics, critical issues, climate change, renewable energy, and other key issues that also we can address with AI and quantum of equal concern. And I think it's great that you've brought together this roundtable to address this in this context. And I hope in further talks, we can address it in other contexts and sectors as well. So just to set the stage, the experts in the room will know this, but just to remind us for those watching today and perhaps on video in the future, we have a major issue in drug discovery and development. It costs us on average 2.5 billion euro to develop a molecule to a medicine. It takes on average 13, 14 years for that process to occur. And we're still seeing, after all that, 70%+ failure rates in clinical trials. And most alarmingly, 40% of those of that failure is in phase three. And as we all know, phase one is a small study for safety, phase two for efficacy, and then we scale it up in phase three. And to fail in phase three is not only disastrous from an economic point of view for the company and medical centers involved, that's the most expensive phase, but also for the patients that will not benefit from that drug because it did fail out. Half the failures typically are for lack of efficacy at scale. The signal seen in phase two is not seen in the greater scale, and half are from toxicity, side effects that are not able to overcome from a point of view of separating the cohorts or addressing them, and therefore the drug cannot proceed to market. And so we have a major issue here if we want to address these diseases, but we're kind of going in the wrong direction. We actually, if we compare ourselves in this industry to 10, 20, 30 years ago, we're not moving at all at Moore's Law. In fact, we're moving kind of in the reverse of Moore's Law. So we call it Eroom's Law, Moore's backwards. And unfortunately, we have a situation that is not helping us to get to clinic faster, de-risking the molecule. So today we're going to talk about how we can use both AI and quantum to address these issues. And I welcome also the comments as we go along here of many colleagues from pharmaceutical companies and many other wonderful companies that have been assembled here. To remind ourselves, AI has had this explosion. We all know about it. It's not an overnight success. This is 35 years in the making to get us to this point of the increasing size of these models. And we're seeing step function change and emergent behavior that helps us at different levels. Driving this revolution, of course, is the GPU. The G, of course, graphics for the initial application of GPUs to make video games better. So when you see a teenager playing video games, thank them for the development of the GPU, because that's why we have the GPUs that are driving the increased complexity and size of the neural networks of today, which drive deep learning. And as we'll see today in my comments, the GPU is not only driving the revolution in terms of more complexity, more layers, more nodes in artificial neural nets driving deep learning, but it's also helping us to design and implement simulations on the quantum interactions happening at the quantum chemistry level of these molecules. And so the GPUs have now been hijacked once from the video game folks for AI, and now a second time for quantum simulation. And here's just an array of some of the LLMs, large language models, and other AIs that have popped up over the last number of years. You can see that in blue, we have the proprietary or closed source models. In bold black, we see the open source models that are proliferating as well. And then, of course, there's some private models. But what's interesting here is that this is not just about proprietary models owned by large companies. There are an increasing number of open source models, some put out by large companies, others put out by collectives of academics and other nonprofits. And so we're seeing a lot of creativity here, and access is now available both to some of the large models on a web basis, but also if you want to dig into how it's working, if you want more visibility, more transparency, more understanding of what it's doing in the black box, Those are particularly available when you look at the open source models where we can code. And so I think this is a very positive trend from a responsible AI use perspective, having, yes, wonderful, what we call frontier models from companies spending hundreds of millions to now billions of dollars to pave the way, but also tremendous opportunity with the open source models. And we encourage the open source community to continue along this road. Along those lines, we also have seen advances in AI, for example, in prediction of protein folding. We all know that strings of amino acids on their own are not as helpful as a prediction on the quaternary structure, the three-dimensional structure of a protein, and that gives it its power to act in the body. AI, in terms of Google DeepMind, in terms of AlphaFold, is well known, but others have now come out. Meta has a wonderful competitor to AlphaFold that they have released and also published in Nature. And that's a very positive sign. We want to see a many polar, multipolar world in terms of all these AIs that are coming out. And those are now available. We've seen some of the first AI-driven drugs start to enter clinic. But it also raises the question, with 10 years now of AI-driven drug discovery, why are we not seeing more of this? And to address this, I want to kind of pull out to a larger picture of quantum information science. We all know that the interaction of a molecule with a receptor, as an example, is a quantum interaction. It's not described by Newtonian laws. It's not described by physics that came before 1900. Rather, it is described by quantum physics. And these interactions, we have the equations for, but they're quite compute intensive. And so until recently, it was really not practical on a scalable basis to run the models for complex molecules, the kind that are pharmaceutically interesting. And the combination of chemistry, physics, and AI coming from the computing world is what now allows us to create this new science, quantum information science, QIS, that we're now seeing degrees dedicated to, masters and PhDs in many universities around the world. And this interaction between the world of AI, where we have lots of data to train on, and in the world of physics, where we can work from first principles bottom up to build new synthetic data sets where data does not exist. By definition, if I have a novel drug, I don't necessarily have a lot of data. AI today, the way it's constructed today, really works best when we have huge amounts of data that we can ingest and work on. In the case of the LLMs, in most of the cases of the LLMs, it's the whole web that it was trained on. But in the case of a novel drug, we don't have that luxury of having massive amounts of data. In this case, quantum really comes to the fore. And these GPUs that I mentioned are being designed by many, many companies, dedicated chip companies such as NVIDIA, of course, but now many other companies have gotten into the game. And that's a positive trend that we see to provide diversity in terms of these approaches. We have the classical computer, of course, where traditionally we've had computing for the last 50, 60 years. We are on the precipice of the next number of years coming up with a quantum computer, but quantum computers today are not impactful from a biopharma perspective. They don't have the error correction that we need. They don't have the scale we need. We're in the regime today of a few hundred qubits. There's seven major ways to build a quantum computer, wonderful companies working on that all around the world. And we interact at Sandbox with many of those companies because we take a neutral status of let's encourage all quantum computers to develop. But unfortunately, today, as we are speaking right now in this forum, quantum computers are not at a scale to be impactful in biopharma. Rather, I'd like to highlight for the roundtable the ability to use GPUs in novel ways, just as they're being used in novel ways by the AI deep learning methodologies. Also, we can apply a technique called tensor networks. This comes to us from condensed matter physics, a branch of physics that is really trained and focused on how does a material that is resistive to electric current at one temperature suddenly lose that resistive tendency at lower temperatures, so-called superconductors. And so the condensed matter physicists developed these wonderful mathematical models over a series of decades to actually model these very complex high-dimensional systems. And we can now repurpose tensor networks on GPUs with this increased capacity to actually start to model biopharma molecules in this area. And so that really gives us a lot of opportunity to combine it then with AI. We can build up synthetic models of the interaction of these molecules and these, more specifically, the electrons at the valence, at the edge of the atoms of the molecule with the electrons at the edge of the receptor, say, in the body. Once we have a data set, then we can apply AI to that in a very traditional way to then drive optimization for the biopharma objective in question. And this is just a graphic that shows that this is an iterative process. This doesn't happen on a once-off basis and suddenly you come out, voila, with a magical compound. This is something that is designed through iteration after iteration, first in silico with models, as I mentioned, both on the quantum and the AI side, predicting structures that would be very effective and optimized here. We then synthesize those and we test those in vitro and then go back to the models in a continuous loop. And we have now shown this, and others have shown this as well, with real molecules in the real world for neurodegen, for oncology, for other major diseases. And so this approach really veers us off to a new road in terms of drug discovery, rather than kind of a whack-a-mole scenario of trying to optimize for individual parameters that we look for in biopharma, and then finding that by optimizing one, we've now lost optimization on the other. We can now look at multiple properties, be it binding affinity, be it selectivity or others, and optimize for all those in one go. And then continuously, of course, synthesizing, characterizing, coming back to the model. This is generally an 18-month process rather than the multi-year, 5 to 10 year process that sometimes it takes. And so we're seeing application both in the earliest phase of drug discovery, as well as in preclinical, even clinical. You might ask, how is this applicable in the clinical setting when the drug is already, kind of locked in? Well, in that case, we're dealing with a real world scenario right now of a major drug company with a phase 3 that was halted by the FDA. And using these techniques, we can begin to elucidate the toxicity that emerged in that phase 3 study so that we can begin to explain what it is and hopefully get that halt lifted and move ahead. So this is an exciting moment. This is early days in terms of using all these techniques together. This is where AI and quantum can start to work together. There's a number of benefits, but also key areas to address from a responsible use of AI and quantum. As we further succeed with the industry in applying both AI and quantum, we can lower the cost of drugs. One of the reasons why drugs are so expensive today is that the handful of drugs that succeed, those programs, unfortunately, have to pay for the 70%+ that fail. And so that's one of the drivers of the enormous cost that we have. In the United States, I think it's quite well known, of the $4.2 trillion that we spend on healthcare, $650 billion of that each year is on prescription medicine, with more money also spent on over-the-counter. And so how do we contain these costs? How do we bring costs down? We have to de-risk these drugs well before they get to clinical trial so that we can lower the entire risk profile of the drug programs and therefore deliver what the biopharma needs, but also what the patient needs. We can get faster time to clinic this way as well. I mentioned the 13 years that it typically takes. Federated learning is another technique that perhaps some of my colleagues will delve more into. I won't get into it today, but I think it holds a special role here in responsible use of AI. When we know already that there's so much wonderful clinical data in the EHRs and EMRs, electronic health records, siloed in hospitals around the world, how do we get at that with still maintaining privacy protecting models? And federated learning is one way to do that and holds a lot of promise. I hope we can see more of that usage in the coming years. We also have to make sure that when we use LLMs, for example, to synthesize and summarize the tsunami of peer-reviewed literature that we each are hit with every single day, new articles in Archive, Bioarchive, Nature, Science, all these different journals hitting us. We can use LLMs certainly, but as the cautionary tale of that lawyer who found out the hard way that LLMs sometimes could hallucinate We have to make sure that we're not hallucinating when reading some of these syntheses. And also, the good news is, in terms of the responsible use of AI and quantum in the bio area, we have actually a body of existing laws and frameworks globally signed onto by dozens of countries to make sure that people are not developing nefarious bioweapons and other types of technologies. And so let's bring those to fore to make sure that as we spread and democratize the access of AI and quantum, we're not losing sight of those possible nefarious negative uses of this technology as well. So with that, I would say, in summary, there's a lot of opportunity here to dramatically change what we've seen as a major blockage and challenge in the biopharmaceutical space. We've all dealt with this. I started my own career at NIH running clinical trials, and I can tell you back then and now, it is a very frustrating experience trying to get a drug from molecule to medicine. And I think these tools hold the promise of starting to really tackle this today. What I hope I showed today is that we don't have to wait for quantum computers, physical quantum computers, to have quantum help us. We can begin with this wonderful new compute that GPUs give us, the ability to both run wonderful AI tools, but in the case of biopharma, where we often really have to create new synthetic data of the interactions of the electrons, we can use quantum techniques on GPUs as today's solution and then apply AI with that